Assalamu alaikum students, hope you all are fine. Today we will cover the remaining section of chapter number 19 from your lower secondary science 1 book, and our topic is food, our source of energy. This is week 2, 13th April 2020 to 17th April 2020. The resources used for this lecture are lower secondary science 1, chapter number 19, and we will cover pages from page number 224 to 232. The methodology used in this lecture is audio and visual aids. There are some diagrams, some flow charts, and at the end there is a homework assignment. The objectives of this lesson is this, that by the end of this lecture you will be able to recognize different type of food classes, their importance, difference between these classes, what are different sources of these classes, and are there any diseases caused by deficiency or excess of these classes. Then there is a brief concept of energy value of food and balanced diet. So recalling your previous lecture, in your previous lecture we discussed that how food acts as a source of energy. What is the unit of energy? It was joule, kilojoule, calorie or kilocalorie. And there are 7 classes of food, including carbohydrates, fats, proteins, minerals, vitamins, fiber and water. In our previous class, we covered that carbohydrates and fats are energy giving food, their sources, and then proteins. These are foods, and what are the sources of proteins, and then protective foods, minerals, that these are required in very small amount, and these are important for the regular functioning of our body. In this lecture, we will cover the remaining classes of food, which are vitamins, water and fiber. Then we will discuss what is energy value of food and what is a balanced diet. What type of diet is known as balanced diet? So, starting from vitamins, these are organic compounds and these are like minerals needed in very small amounts. We can classify vitamins into two groups, water soluble and fat soluble. Water soluble examples are vitamin B complex and vitamin C, whereas fat soluble vitamins are vitamin A, D, E and K. Now, as the word indicates, water soluble, these vitamins are easily soluble in water. These get dissolved in water and are excreted out with wastewater. So, we need a regular intake of these vitamins. Whereas fat soluble vitamins dissolve in fats and are stored in our body along with fats. Storage of vitamin is good, that whenever we need vitamin it is used, but excess storage of vitamin can cause toxicity in our body as these are required in only very small amounts. Now here is the word vitamin B complex. So a question should rise in your mind, that what does the word complex stands for? Is it only one vitamin or these are the group of vitamins? So the answer to this is that vitamin B complex is basically composed of 8 B vitamins, including vitamin B1, B2, B3, B5, B6, 7, 9 and 12. Each of these have a separate important function in our body and these are required for different performance of functions. Against chemical injury, and its deficiency can cause dry hair, heart diseases, muscular disorders. Whereas the food sources include are egg yolk, nuts, vegetable oils and wheat germs. The last one is vitamin K. Vitamin K is basically important for clotting of blood. If we get hurt or we are bleeding, then we need something to clot that blood, and among all other things, vitamin K is also important for blood clotting. Its deficiency can cause bruises easily and prolonged bleeding. Food sources include green vegetables, liver, egg yolk, and vitamin K is also made in the gut. So, these are protective foods, vitamins and minerals. Vitamins include vitamin A, B, C, D, E and K. And minerals include calcium, iodine, iron along with other minerals. So the deficiency, this is just a summary of their deficiency diseases, that poor vision is caused by deficiency of vitamin A, beriberi is caused by deficiency of vitamin B, scurvy is caused by deficiency of vitamin C, and rickets is caused by deficiency of vitamin D. You can also add on your notebook vitamin E and K and their deficiency diseases. Then talking about minerals, deficiency of calcium causes bone and tooth decay. Deficiency of iodine can cause a disease known as goiter, in which there is not proper functioning of thyroid gland, as we have discussed in our previous lecture. Whereas deficiency of iron causes anemia, which is basically lack of hemoglobin or blood in our body. Next topic is fiber. This is the sixth class of food. Fiber is also known as roughage. It is made up of cellulose which cannot be broken down by our body. If you remember cell structure, then the cell wall of plants is made up of cellulose. And we cannot digest cellulose in our stomach or in our digestive system. We lack those important bacteria which are basically responsible for the digestion of cellulose. That's why food containing fiber passes right through our body and is excreted out as feces. The important function of fiber is that it keeps our intestine healthy and working properly. If we will not take fiber properly in our diet, we can suffer from constipation, damage to our intestine, piles in which we get blood with feces, appendicitis in which we have some problem with our appendix, we suffer from pain and ultimately we have to remove our appendix. Then there is bowel cancer. What is the state of food during digestion, and when our intestine is not healthy or when we get rotten food particles in our intestine, we can develop bowel cancer. Its sources include brown bread or brown bread, whole grain bread, brown rice, leafy and crunchy vegetables, fruits, pasta, beans and lentils. Now there is a science tidbit for your information, that animals such as cows, sheep and goats are called ruminants, as they are able to digest or break down cellulose with the help of bacteria in their stomach. Their stomachs basically have four chambers, and these chambers contain different bacteria which help them to digest cellulose properly. Number 7 is water. Water is very essential for our life, and I believe all of you know that our body consists of 70% of water by our body weight. It means that if you are weighing 100 pounds, then 70 pounds will be water, or if you are weighing 100 kilograms, 70 kilograms of water will be there in your body in the form of blood, in the form of fluids in our body, then the fluids present in our joints, and even the fluid present in our brain. Function of water is that it is needed for breaking down food. It provides a medium for many chemical reactions to occur. Then it helps in dissolving and transporting nutrients. then it is the main constituents of blood, plasma in cells, and it is important for chemical reactions to take place in cytoplasm. If you remember, what is cytoplasm? In any plant or animal cell, the liquid part which surrounds the nucleus, and it is bounded by a cellular membrane or a plasma membrane, it is cytoplasm, and it is basically made up of water. It is a viscous jelly like substance. Now, how the water is removed from our body? It is removed through urination, perspiration, that is when we perspire or when we sweat, and then through the air that we breathe out. Now the question is, what is the daily need of water to our body? So for an average, we should drink 2 to 3 liters of water per day, which makes 6 to 8 glasses. Besides this, we can take in water through fruits like watermelon, melon, grape, or we can take in juices or milk or something liquidy which contains water. So this was the food classes. Now I will just sum these up. Number one, we discussed carbohydrates and fats as energy giving food. Then we discussed proteins as bodybuilding foods. Then we discussed minerals and vitamins as protective food. Then fiber and water as other essentials, other important factor, other important classes for food, for body. Now in this diagram or in this picture, you can see that on first column, there are different classes of food, their functions and their examples. We have already discussed all these during our lecture, so you can just take a look on this for your information or to revise your concept. Then there is energy value of food. We have discussed so far that food is the source of energy. Now the question should arise in your mind that how much of energy is stored in food, and is every amount of food, of different type of food, give us same energy? Like let's suppose we are intaking some fruit and we are intaking some bread. 1 gram of fruit and 1 gram of bread, are they giving us same amount of energy? Which type of classes are there, and which class is providing what amount of energy? So we can discuss all these things by measuring amount of energy present in our body. Now the question is how we would measure this energy. So the amount of stored energy is found by burning a known mass of food in a calorie meter. Calorie meter is basically an instrument. I will show you diagrams in next slide. And in this we burn food to calculate that how much of energy is produced by that specific food. Talking about energy value, so its definition is the amount of heat released from burning a fixed mass of food is equal to the amount of stored energy in the food. This is known as energy value. That whatever amount of energy we get by burning a specific food is basically amount of energy stored in that food. Okay, like if we are burning 1 gram of carbohydrates and it is providing us, let's suppose, 2 joules, it means 1 gram of carbohydrates stores 2 joules. This is not like I'm just giving you example. Okay, it is not a fixed thing that 1 gram is providing 2 joules. No, I'm just giving you example to let you understand that how we are relating energy get by heating that food and energy stored in that food. So this is a diagram of calorie meter in which we burn food, okay, and then we get amount of energy by burning this food, and we relate that, okay, if we are getting this much of energy, so this is basically energy stored in that specific food. Now, according to your lower secondary science 1, you can see a graph here. It is telling us about energy values of carbohydrates, fats and proteins. That if we are burning 1 gram of carbohydrates, it is providing us with 17 kilojoule of energy. And when we are burning 1 gram of fats, it is providing us with 37 kilojoule of energy, which is almost double of energy given by carbohydrates. Then protein is also giving us energy, which is by burning 1 gram of protein give us 17 kilojoule of energy. So there is a question here that why do you think Eskimos prefer to eat fats instead of carbohydrates to keep their bodies warm? So answer is very clear that carbohydrates provide less amount of energy than fats, and fats provide us with double amount of energy than carbohydrates. This is the reason that why Eskimos eat more fats as compared to carbohydrates. Then a question comes, then we have read about whole 7 classes of food. Now how much of that classes should be in our food? Should we take in carbohydrates more? Should we take in fats more? Should we take in proteins more? How much of water should be intaken? Okay. So all these things will come under the fact that how we should balance our diet. So first of all, you should be clear with one thing, that diet is anything that we eat or drink. And we call a diet a varied diet when it consists of different type of foods from various classes. Let's suppose you are eating a burger. It contains carbohydrates in the form of its bun. It contains proteins and fats in the form of the patty. Then there will be some vegetables in it, so they will provide some fiber and some important minerals and vitamins. So this it will be a varied diet, okay? Or if we are having some burger with some milkshake or some other thing, so it will also be a varied diet because it contains different type of foods from various classes. So how we should balance our diet? The answer to this is that the energy requirement is different among different individuals, okay? So different individuals have different energy requirement, and their food should be balanced according to their energy requirement. It basically tells about the type and quantity of food taken in by the individuals. For example, energy requirement of an athlete is totally different from energy requirement of a baby. This is a graph in which you can see different daily energy requirement of different individuals, and the energy is given on your vertical line in kilojoules, and different individuals are given on your horizontal line. You can see here that a baby needs only 4600 kilojoule of energy daily because he does not have to do much work. He just needs energy to be grown up. Whereas if you look at 11, it's a pink bar, the highest one, 11 year old thin boy, very active, he needs 16,500 kilojoules of energy. Why? Because he requires a lot of energy for doing different tasks, like for studying, for having some some sports, and he also needs some energy to be grown up. So his energy requirement is much more. You can see this graph on your page number 228. So what you should do, you should look for energy requirement of each class, and you should think that why energy requirement is different in each case. The energy requirement will be different according to their mode of energy, their rate of activeness and their age. Then there are some questions on your page number 229. I am reading it out. That answer the following questions using the bar chart which I have shown you before to find out the factors which affect the daily energy requirement of an individual. Okay, so we have to discuss different factors like their age, their activities, okay, and their food intake. In what ways will the energy requirement change? When I will discuss one question with you and then you have to do the remaining by considering that graph and doing it for your practice. It will increase your understanding of this energy requirement thing. So the first question is, the individual grows from a baby to an adult. As we have discussed, I will discuss a baby and a teenage boy. A baby requires less energy than a teenage boy. Energy requirement of a baby was only 4600, whereas a teenage boy needed energy, it was I guess 16500, which was around 3 times of the energy requirement of a baby. So what's the difference? So as I have discussed before, that it will depend upon their need of energy. The baby needs only energy for its growth, whereas a boy or an adult needs energy for performing different actions as well, to perform different activities, to grow up. So that's why the energy requirement for a baby is different from that of an adult, and the factors included will be its age, its activity and its food intake. Okay, so discuss all these questions with your parents and discuss different factors which are affecting the different daily energy requirement and how energy requirement is changing. So besides energy requirement, people also have some special needs. Like a growing child needs plenty of proteins for making new tissues. As we know, proteins are bodybuilding foods, so new proteins are needed for making new tissues. A pregnant mother needs extra proteins, iron and calcium for developing baby. An athlete needs more proteins for muscle buildup and plenty of simple sugars for instant energy. You have also noticed that athletes basically they get more protein powder, they are on protein diet and they also drink a lot of energy drinks. So proteins is for bodybuilding. And the energy drink or simple sugars are to get them and to give them more energy. Then we will come to the point, balanced diet. Now we know that energy requirement for every age group is different and it will depend upon its activity. So depending upon that, we can say that balanced diet contains the right amount of carbohydrates, fats, vitamins, minerals, water and fiber to meet the daily requirement of body. Important point is that it varies with lifestyle, activities and age. So this is just a pyramid. I have given you this pyramid to tell you that which foods are good for us and which we should select more in our diet and which we should select less in our diet. You can see that the most thing with which we should eat is rice and alternative containing carbohydrates so that we get more energy. Then there are fruits and vegetables giving us different minerals and vitamins which we need. And then we should take up meats and alternatives providing us proteins. And the least thing which we should use is excess sugars and excess fats, because these can cause a lot of health problems. So this can give you a understanding, or it can give you a scale that if whatever you are intaking, which thing should be more in your diet. There is an activity in the end which I will tell you to do for the whole week, and this graph, this pie chart, or this what we can say energy pyramid can tell you, can guide you that what type of food you are intaking. So, the activity is that keep a food diary, by writing down the types and amount of food you eat at each meal for 1 week. Which type of nutrients did you consume the most? Which type of nutrients did you consume the least? Compare what you have eaten to the guidelines given in that pyramid, and depending upon that pyramid guidelines, tell that is your diet balanced and healthy, and if it is not healthy and balanced, what you should do to make it healthy and balanced. This is the whole summary of your this chapter, that different component of foods are required depending upon age, level of activity, your health and your gender. And all depending upon all these factors, when we decide food, it make it a balanced diet. Different components of food includes carbohydrates, fats, proteins, vitamins, minerals, fiber and water. Carbohydrates and fats are energy giving foods, proteins are bodybuilding foods, vitamins and minerals are protective foods, whereas fiber and water helps to remove undigested part and clean our body. Deficiency of these components of food can lead us to different diseases. Their excess can also be harmful, so we should balance these components in our food to lead a healthy and balanced life. So I hope this lecture have given you an understanding of food as source of energy, what type of classes of food there are, and what is the balanced diet, what type of energy is present in those classes of food, what are different functions of classes of food, and how we can choose a healthy and balanced diet for our body. So the assignment for this week is that you have to prepare a test for the whole chapter, and once you are done with the learning of whole chapter, you should open the assignment given in assignment task. There is a 10 marks test there, that's your assessment test. So just do that test on your loose sheets or register wherever you are doing your assignment, and then you can, when the answer key will be uploaded, just mark it with the pencil. Okay, and then I will tell you about further instructions that how we can get that test. So this was all about your chapter number 19, food. Hope you have understood this thing well. And if you have any queries or any there are some questions in your mind, you are open to ask your teachers in your class groups. Thank you so much.